All right, we are back here at the All In for Wishes, fourth annual event here in Albany, New York, the Empire Convention Center, to the tournament to benefit Make-A-Wish Foundation, and we just missed a big action hand. One of our featured players has been here for 3 hours. Jared Jones took a big hit. He flopped a set. There was a lead-out bet from Vincent in seat number six. Jared went all in. Vincent called him and got runner-runner flush to take a huge pot, and he's now the chip leader at the table, and he's got to be one of the leaders now probably in the tournament. And I'm sure you've been on the wrong end of that before.
Yeah.
You flop a top set, and you're in good shape. You get a call when you want a call, and it doesn't hold up.
Yeah, playing big pots in tournaments is very fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, you certainly made it look fun, and I would imagine, you know, when you're in the involvement, and we talked about this a little bit yesterday, when you got three-handed with Sylvia and that whole situation in Balzinger last year in the main event, I mean, for you it wasn't a lot of fun, but when you look back on it, you got to be really happy with your play. I saw a lot of really impeccable play three-handed, and it took for that to last that long, and to see the swings that you had, and you took a couple of horrendous beats when you had people dead, and you were able to overcome it. And you, when looking back on that, it's hard for a player like yourself to look at that, but when you sort of give yourself a self-critique at any point of it, has anybody kind of said, hey, that was pretty good? That was pretty good stuff.
Yeah, a lot of people have like commended me on that, and even when I look back and watch it myself, seeing the Kings versus Ace King hand and watching the run out and the river makes my stomach like sick every time.
Because you handle it well. A lot of people in that spot don't handle it well.
Yeah, it's just like when you have that opportunity that's only going to happen once in your lifetime, you just shouldn't ever let something like that affect your decisions. I mean, mm-hmm. There's nothing you can do, and if anything, it was just gonna. It's always like if you're gonna go out of a tournament and people are gonna remember how you like lost most of your chips, at least it was gonna be like if I were to get second or third, at least it would have been like, oh, he lost King's Ace King, he would have won.
Right.
It wasn't like, oh, he made a bad call or mm-hmm. or he bluffed it off. Like
you want to put a good, you want to put
you
in
get
good,
like the sympathy.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. And we see Aaron there in the Montreal Expo sat in seat number one, go all in with Queens, and Vinny, who just more than doubled up in the previous big spot that weren't able to show you just before we went back on the air. He folded correctly with sevens in that spot, not going to call roughly half a stack with sevens to an all in preflop with Queens, and a good prudent play by him as we get back to action. Blinds are at 5 and 10, no antes, as Greg alluded to the last hour, which in a charity tournament like that, you want to give them some opportunity to play, and you don't want the ante to come into play, but at the same time, with the blinds going up so fast, it is still a pretty accelerated structure.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, this is the most basic form of poker available, and if you're trying to learn how to play, this is one of the best places to start, is with the very short stacks where your decisions are limited to one or two decisions at the most in a single hand, whereas cash games are.
And when you sat down at this table right before we went on the air, I mean, Bev Swim is still sitting in seat nine. She hasn't had more than 10 big blinds at any point, and she's still here, and she hasn't been out of line one time. She's put it in every time. She's put it in good. She's gotten called a couple of times with the best hand, and she's gotten away from it when she didn't. And once again, she goes all in. She's ace eight. On the button, she's only got two people, and that's the right play.
Yeah, for sure. And Aaron should go all in here.
You think that's contemplating?
Yeah, I mean,
we haven't seen his hand yet, so we don't know, but
He's folding.
He's folding.
But Aaron should go all in because he's getting the right price, and if he gets ambushed by the big blind only starts the hand with four big blinds or five, so it doesn't matter. It's roughly the same amount. And
I think, you know, seeing his play, you weren't here for a few times earlier because he gotten burned in a couple of spots. I think 2 hours ago, he probably would have made that call. But because of he's taken a couple of bad beats, or not necessarily bad beats, but he took a couple of big hits that hurt his stack. He was a little hesitant in that, and I think he understood that Bev was putting it in with.
Yeah, that's another thing too. Like if he thinks that she's only going to have good hands, then I guess it's like close that he could fold. But I don't know. There's 15,000 in the pot, and she's going all in for 36, and you already have 5K invested with the big blind not having many chips, so you're not risking the big blind waking up with the big hand. He has the chips to afford it. I would have went with it, but I don't mind him folding if he thinks that she's only going to go all in with good hands.
We see Jared, and he's still reeling from that hand that he took a big hit, and he'd been playing very, very well at this table, and again, he put his money in with the goods, and he got exactly what he wanted in that situation. He got a raise after the flop. He flopped top set and runner for Vinny to get the flush, and that he's and that's the I guess you know what you want to see. And he's not got out of line since then, and that's an easy thing to do when you take a bad beat like that.
So yeah,
you see a lot of people do that, don't you?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, people are like less likely to want to pull the trigger after losing big pots where they've been burned or unlucky.
And we see
all-in blind versus blind.
That's good. Yeah, that's what you wanted to see the previous hand when he was on the button, right?
Yes. We'll see what happens this time if he folds around. But think about that queen-jack spot. If she looks down at, like, jack-9 suited or jack-10 suited, I mean, is she really just going to fold? I don't think so.
No,
so,
probably not.
Nine, yeah.
I agree with
8,
you.
8-9 suited, whatever, queen 8 suited. I mean, I just think she's going to go all in. I mean, I could be wrong, but.
Well, this is an interesting situation. Vinny blimps in with 8s, and William, who's been pretty aggressive when he's had hands, at least pre-flop, is just, looks like just going to call with the 7s, which, you know, for him, if he knew what he was against, it's probably absolutely the right thing to do, but two pocket pairs in early position, both just limp in, which is a little surprising seeing we've only had Vinny here for about a half hour, but he's been very aggressive in his plays.
Yeah,
he is going to raise. Okay. He pushed in 2 chips, but then I think he must have verbaled the bet. We didn't hear it. So this could get bad for William if Vinny feels that his 8s are good. And we'll see if anybody else has a big hand, if it gets around to him. Stan Merson is the father of Greg Merson, our distinguished color commentator here in this particular spot, and he's the one with the dark blue hat sitting in seat number 2, which 3 really, but it's 2 on our table. And it's folded around, and Lynn has pocket 6s, and we've seen her fold after big flops where she had the best hand both times, and she folded, and she's got 6s, and she's thinking about it, and she's going to make the right lay down there with a raise and a re-raise, and back to Vinny.
They do, yeah.
And he calls 36,000. So we'll see a flop with 2 pocket pairs, and William is in trouble if he doesn't better himself here. And he will not. Vinny first acts.
All the money is going in.
Yes, yeah. I would imagine. With that flop, unless he really feels that, and we're gonna get exactly what you said, Greg. And I was thinking the same thing as soon as we saw that flop. I said this money's all going all in here, and William's gonna need a heap of help here, as 2 comes off on the turn, and the river is a 6. And Lynn's going, I should have stayed in with my 6s.
Yeah, I saw it look like that.
That was a look like if you didn't know, then you knew that she just spiked something on the river. And Vinny has gotten very, very healthy here in the last 20 minutes. Right before we came back on the air, he won a huge hand where he put it in. He called an all-in bet when he was against a set, and he got runner flush. William has been here for a while, and he goes out in the 8s versus 7s, and Vinny is up to 300,000. The blinds are at 5 and 10, so he's got 30 big blinds. And in this short structure, that has got to be one of the bigger stacks with about 40 to play.
Yeah, for sure. Are you going to come tonight? Yeah, he's definitely in the top 3.
Nobody really did anything wrong. I mean, you knew that was probably going to happen. I was surprised that I was initially thinking maybe William was just calling there, but he obviously verbaled and he gave a raise. He put out his 10, and then he obviously shoved. And Vinny, you know, in that spot with his stack, he's not going to fold there.
Yeah, I mean, if he has two sevens there, it's actually probably just a fold because there's like six people behind him, and the guy who's limping under the gun probably isn't limping with like sixes or fives.
Especially what he's shown.
Yeah.
His tendencies so far at this table, he's been very, very aggressive. And we see Lynn with ace 10, and she decides just to call. It didn't register on the screen initially, but she put out more than 10,000, and she did. And she will take it down, and that was the right play. We see Lynn at 122,000. She's taken a hit to her stack here since she sat down. I think she sat down with roughly about 140. She was up to about 180 at one point, and then she folded queens in that. I'd love to find out what that happened. What was the play? Obviously, William went all in. We didn't hear it on the audio, but she took a hit there.
Is the next blind level 612?
612, I believe. So we're going to see a lot of action here pre-flop pretty much for the next hour or so.
All in, all in, all in, all in, all in. Fair
enough. He's thinking, and he's gonna fold.
No.
it's agonizing. So you're agonizing more about his hands than you would be about your own.
Yeah.
He wasn't quite on the button like he was the previous time in that spot, but there's six folds, so he's.
Well, he would have got ambushed by ace king.
So. He's saying, hey, look, I made the right play.
Yeah.
And Vinny has been very, very aggressive, and no doubt he's going to raise, and he did. He raised it 25, and Jared, who's taken a bad beat, finally puts it in behind. He has not been behind any spot where money's gone in until now, and unfortunately for him, he runs into ace-king, and he's going to need help, and he didn't get it on the flop. He needs a 10, and he does not get it. Jared Jones, been a very strong player.
We would have won with King 9.
He would have won with King 9. So he was bad to do it. Then he was okay against the Ace King, but then it winds up it would have held up. Little did he know. But you'll tell him about it though.
Yeah, I mean, you just can't really wait for a better spot. We have four big blinds. The likelihood of picking up a hand better than the hand we just had in the next.
Well, and you know it as well as and people that are watching this that play some poker. I mean, if he's first or second position, he's not going to do that. But with all the folds around, he's king nine in that spot is more than average.
Yeah, yep. Yeah. And so now we're two from being in the big blind. And yeah, I mean, it's just. We'll see. We're going all in.
How much when you
rewarded for the patience?
There you go. See, he got it in a better spot with ace 10, where he felt was a better spot.
Yeah.
This time he's gonna probably take it down. But Vinny has got pocket deuces, and he's gonna at least think about it. He wants a count, and that's. He's got 300,000, so he's calling off about 1/6 of his stack if he does call this. What would you do in this spot?
It's definitely a fold.
I mean, I think it is too.
Yeah.
I think he's going to do that as well.
The only time I would call there is if I was in the big blind,
mm-hmm.
where you're closing the action and can't have someone wake up with the hand behind you.
Right. I wanted to ask you, because people may not know this or maybe didn't realize this when you won the main event last year. Right before then, you won the six-handed championship, and I know that's something that you are very proud of. What is the difference for players that are, I want to say novice, but, you know, play some tournaments, the difference in the six-handed structure, and what do you think are some of the keys to be successful in that kind of format?
I'd say the biggest edge I have on those fields is that the pros either play too tight or too loose for six-handed play.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason I can really like distinguish between that is because that's the only form of poker I've spent.
Because you do that, that's your cash game.
Yeah.
A lot of your cash game
yeah, play like three-handed, six-handed, and then when you're playing six-handed, you know, often you'll go to five-handed when someone gets knocked out. Sometimes four-handed, and then obviously to win, it's going to go 5-4-3. And yeah, just like having the experience of knowing how to play three-handed, four-handed, five-handed, because it changes so drastically.
Mm-hmm.
Where the tournament players just pretty much only get to play nine-handed. It's just hard for them to adjust to a format of poker that I've spent my whole career focusing on. The same way that they have all the experience playing nine-handed,
right,
whereas I'm learning on the fly.
Mm-hmm.
And also the heads-up players that only play heads-up are mm-hmm. going to dominate
sure.
those heads-up tournaments. So it's really just like
a comfort
of,
level.
Yeah.
You've done it, and you know, obviously when the Texas Hold'em, you know, there was a lot of people that, you know, when they got into it years ago, they were playing seven card stud, and
mm-hmm.
they had that advantage. And when the World Series events would be held in that, they do well. It's their comfort level, and
yeah.
your specialty is the six handed. And I see, you know, I've talked to some players, the younger players, and it's interesting because I've heard some of them say, "Oh, I absolutely love it," and then I hear the exact. There's no middle ground. It's either they absolutely love it or they absolutely hate it.
The shorthanded,
right?
Yeah. And yeah, like it makes sense for the tourney guys to focus on nine-handed because, you know, 98% of
where the money's is right now.
Are,
yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I'm excited. I just started doing some studying on PLO and playing PLO recently, like a lot more seriously than I had in the past.
Mm-hmm.
And it's gonna give me it's gonna give me more chances to win bracelets moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
Being able to play an extra 3, 4, or 5 events a summer. You know, I'm pretty jealous of these guys that can just hop in any event and play any game at a pretty high level and have a chance.
It had to feel good for you because, you know, obviously you won the 2 World Series bracelets in 2012, but you only played 7 events. So, yeah, you got points for winning those tournaments, but, you know, that's pretty – you had to feel good to win Player of the Year. A lot of those other guys are playing 2025. The Negranus and the Lindgrens and guys like that that obviously – you know, they cash 7 or 8 times, they're going to be in the points situation.
Yeah,
feel good.
I literally just got reminded of winning Player of the Year a couple of days ago in a tweet where, like, I don't think I had thought about it for at least 3 months because seeing the banner at the Rio, you can't really miss it. But it's just everything, I got everything that I could ask for out of my entire career. All like three accomplishments that could make a career all in a
couple of months.
Yeah, and that's like the last thing that, you know, the six max bracelet gets overshadowed by the main event,
mm-hmm.
and then even more so.
But I know for you personally, stuff. That meant a lot to you.
The six max.
The
bracelet.
Six did.
Yeah,
I knew it
sure.
did.
Yeah.
Yeah, for those people that were right now, this is James Allen. We're joined by Greg Merson, the 2012 not only main event champion, but as he talked about just briefly ago, he was the 2012 World Series Player of the Year. And we're seeing Bev Swim right now in suite number 9, who's been at this table since we've gone on the air. And she's done very, very well with the short stack. She has not been out of line one time. She's either put it in or she's gotten out of the way, and she will fold 10-6 prudently in that spot. And for people that don't know this, you actually played around here when you were in your infancy. A lot of players that I know, Sean Deeb is a local player and you're friends with, and playing at Turning Stone. And how important is that when you're starting out to, yeah, you play online and you play with your friends and you play, you know, you're working your way into the game. But how important was that for your infancy as a poker player to get those opportunities?
Yeah, just amazing to come up with all the guys that are now featured pros on TV, getting sponsorship deals, and really just the new wave of poker pros now in our mid to late 20s, where when we were coming up, we were looking up to all the TV pros, and now we're that new generation of TV pros. So it's pretty cool. Like anytime there's a televised tournament final table, I almost always know at least one guy or have played with one of the guys, and it's just cool to be able to watch and just like read articles or watch interviews or watch these guys on TV, and I know so many of them now, and it's pretty gratifying for us to finally be in the spotlight where, you know, we were mostly just playing online, and like now we all know each other from from playing up at Turning Stone originally, like 5-6 years ago, like anyone who was under 21 and even some people that were over 21 mm-hmm. would still go to Turning Stone for those series. It was just like the meetup place
sure.
every couple months to hang out. And, like, you know, we've all helped each other so much. And although we compete against each other for a lot of money, like, everyone's usually pretty
it's pretty good comment. I mean, I think there was a misconception, Greg, that there's you know, there's some rivalries. You see some, you know, publicized rivalries in poker, but when you're coming up, there's such a camaraderie. You guys are, you know, cutting your teeth in the same way, and sometimes you're traveling to the events and doing those things. I think some people maybe not realize that those kind of things happen.
Yeah, I mean, there's only like one or two people that I know of that severely dislike me, and
I'm not one of them, by the way. I'm just letting you know.
And there's really only like one or two people that I don't care for at all. But other than that, like.
But that's really going to be the way in the way of life anyway. Nobody's ever going to like you completely.
Yeah. But for poker. How many people play poker, the fact that there's only one or two people that I don't care for, mm-hmm. and one or two people that publicly don't care for me. I'm mm-hmm. sure, obviously, there's way more than that, but mm-hmm. I just, the ones that I know of, it's just like makes your job a lot easier to mm-hmm. to show up and travel the world with these guys. And it would suck if you didn't like these people.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's like in any field endeavor. I mean, I'm a reporter for 25 years, and if I didn't love it, it would be kind of a miserable existence. But I'm fortunate that I like my job a lot, and we got a couple more players at the feature table, and Paul Geddes is joining us now. He's at seat number 8. We kind of saw the back of his head as he sat down, and we'll see if he gets involved. And Lynn is making a raise. She's getting a little more aggressive as the stacks are and the blinds are going up, and she's going to get rewarded for her all-in. She immediately goes all-in and takes it down with the ace on the flop, ace 8. That's the kind of flop you want to see when you have that hand. Mm-hmm. And she got rewarded. And structure, we're down. I would have to believe we're down to about 40 players, somewhere in that range. It doesn't seem like we have more than 3 or 4 tables outside of this one. And the blind structures are now going to be going up to 10 and 20. So.
Oh, they are going to 10 and 20.
Yes, so this is going to be the next blinds, the next level. So we're going to see, I would have to imagine that if Dad's going to get one in, he's going to have to get it in pretty soon.
Yeah.
And he is in that spot that he was a few minutes ago, which is 2 spots from the button. So the button has been moving around pretty quickly here.
Yeah, it is, yeah. I mean, there is something to be said for survival because it mm-hmm. is not easy, but fairly easy to mm-hmm. spin up a stack when the blinds are so big to just, you know, get 3 or 4 good hands and then run your stack up.
And Aaron, who's not on the screen right now, but he's the player in the first seat, and he actually raised with pocket eights. He raised it up. The blind structure right now is 6 and 12. He raised to 25, so a little bit more than 2, which is pretty much a standard play in poker these days. That's kind of like been one of the changes over the last 4 or 5 years. You don't see as many 3 and 3.5 time the blinds. You see a lot of little over 2 big blind or raises of the blinds at that point. And that's one of the adjustments I think some of the older players have had a little trouble kind of making the transition to.
And it's so great for tournament players or cash game players that play in tournaments. Like when I post the big blind in a tournament as a cash game player, I'm so happy because, you know, tournament poker is a lot of folding and patience and blind sealing, so not many flops. But I know that when I'm in the big blind, someone's going to min raise and I'm going to defend a fairly wide range of hands depending on the opponent and mm-hmm. how many chips they have. But like I just am so excited to be able to like play a flop.
Oh yeah, you get a heads up situation, and you know that there wasn't much of a raise, and you know what the range of hands you're going to be playing. Well, you're going to feel pretty confident in that situation.
Yeah, I mean, even though I'm going to be out of position, 95% of the time, I'm going to be closing the action, getting 4-1 or a little more than 4-1, and it's just like, especially like shorthanded tournaments, mm-hmm. there's a lot of your edge is going to come from the fact that you can mm-hmm. just like defend your big blind constantly, 3 and 4 handed, and play post flop. Whereas a lot of the 9-handed stuff is all pre flop.
And we see two of our newer players. Ron Miller's the gentleman in the white hat with the all Under Armour hat. And seat number eight is Paul Geddes. He is ace seven of clubs. They go to the flop. Ace king versus ace seven, and not a good flop for ace seven. And it comes check, check. Turn comes a seven, and I have to imagine now that this is the wrong time for Ron to bet, and Paul will do the betting. And we'll see if Ron Miller will call, and it looks like he will. So Paul is not in a good situation. He thinks a seven is in good situation, and he's obviously not in a good situation.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's raising. But...
Yep, and it looks like he is. He's putting together a stack. And that was a good play on the flop. That's a sneaky play with the ace-king.
Yeah, I was going to say that the timing of his check on the flop was so fast that it's just, like, too mm-hmm. fast, and it means...
It's inviting action.
Yeah, it just means, like, strength, because mm-hmm. it's like, all right, I'm going to check real fast, like, I don't have anything. But it's, in fact, the opposite, whereas, mm-hmm. you know, I think if he has more of a marginal hand, he's going to consider betting.
Mm-hmm.
And then if he decides to
And
check,
his action was
check.
So quick.
Yeah, and this is just like, it could be a couple seconds, but mm-hmm. like he checks so fast
yep.
that it's like...
He's boom, either got absolute air or he's check. Got the goods.
Yeah. Well, I think way more often he has it mm-hmm. when he checks that fast.
I agree.
Because like, it's such a good board for him mm-hmm. to just bet. Because it's just king 9-3, no flush.
Sure, there's nothing there. It's
yeah,
a rainbow flop.
If he doesn't
flop.
Have anything, he's probably going to bet and like think for more than half a second before mm-hmm. acting.
Well, he got what he wanted. He got the bet on the turn with the seven, and of course he check raises. And Paul,
yeah, his timing on the turn was
yep.
better.
Yep,
it was more like in control,
mm-hmm.
where you could see in those 2 or 3 seconds that he was actually thinking, all right, what am I gonna do? All right, I'm gonna check. You know, as mm-hmm. whereas the flop was just like instant.
What a tight fold from your dad, 2-6 off. Oh. He folded. I'm kidding. And we see Vinny, who's been the action man in the last hour at this feature table, and he folds queen 8. Comes around to Paul at 5-7. Bev Swim has got a stack of 32,000. And she folded.
No, it was,
oh,
he
she
limped
did.
And he checked.
Oh, he checked. Okay. I was going to say I didn't see any chips in front of her, but now she's going to shove. She's got top pair. And
here comes little mini Hollywood.
Yep. That was very mini. Yeah. That was like, I have nothing. If he had a 6, he at least would have thought about it a little bit. You know, I mean, the gutter. But no, that was not the action that he was hoping for on that particular flop. And Bev Swim's patience once again, and she really hasn't had too many variances in her play. It's been all in her fold, and she's stuck around for over 3 hours with anywhere between 11 and 4 big blinds. That's pretty solid play from her. She hasn't gotten out of line in any spot, and a couple of players have actually respected her on her raises, even though she didn't have that much money because they knew that her range was pretty small.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if, like, I didn't bring this up, but I don't know if you saw when my dad went all in mm-hmm. with ace 10, she folded pocket 8s in the big blind.
Right.
So, like, there's just another great example of why he should have gone mm-hmm. all in with king 9.
Because more often than not, you're going to have some players that maybe are considering, you know, hey, I want to stick around as long as I can, and then I don't want to flip for that. And
yeah, and like
thinking she's behind probably.
Yeah, and eights is the ninth best hand in poker, mm-hmm. right behind ace queen. So like, it should never be a fold there mm-hmm. ever. If people are going to be making those mistakes, you should be mm-hmm.
be capitalizing them every yeah. time. And we see now Lynn, who's gotten a little bit more aggressive of late. She wakes up with king 10 of diamonds. She raises 25, and it looks like it'll be folded around. And it's back to Aaron, who we can't see his cards. And it looks like he's putting together some chips. They look like calling chips. Don't look like raising chips.
These decks are so sick, though, with mm-hmm. the chip mm-hmm. in them. Sick. Someone told me they're $140 a deck.
That is correct.
Yeah.
You won't have any of those in your home game, is what you're saying? Unless you want to have cameras.
Yeah, I know, right? I don't know. I'm like 90% certain that I've been cheated in a home game, and maybe this is one of the ways. I don't know.
You know, obviously, this you probably aren't going to be too. At this point in your career, you're not playing too many home games, unless there's friends.
And, oh, no, just like private games.
Yeah, private games.
Yeah.
Does that happen to more people maybe than people realize? With
all over the world. Yeah. All the best and biggest games are always private.
Mm-hmm.
Always. Because recreational players don't want to show up at a casino to play with 22-year-old kids that wear headphones and don't speak and play tight.
Right.
Like they want to.
They want to be in a conversational situation and
they want
feel more comfortable.
Yeah, they want interactive dealers or good-looking female dealers, and they want three massage girls and a waitress, full-time waitress, and not like the casinos offer a lot of these things, but not like instant whatever you need.
Yeah, I mean, like Bobby's Room will do something like that.
Yeah,
but,
exactly.
But,
you gotta
have some cash to be playing in those games.
Yeah.
I remember when I was there in 2010, I played in the World Series, one of the smaller events, and it was the last day of day two in the main event. And Phil Ivey was actually playing in Bobby's Room with Chow Shang and a few other. I think Phil Galfon was in there, and there was some Russian guy. And I'll never forget Phil Ivey walking out. Some guy was a Russian businessman. He sat down with, he had to have hundreds of thousands of dollars. He blind raised $50,000. They were playing 1-2,000. He blind raised $50,000 with the first hand. Just basically, you know, I'm letting you know I don't care about money.
Yeah.
And Phil walked down. He goes, guy just bet $50,000 blind. And I was like, you know, because he was, I was playing with some people that he knew, and it was hilarious. It's just because, you know, Phil's a pretty quiet guy.
Yeah,
and,
I know. Yeah.
For him to even like come out and make that announcement, but
yeah.
About a couple hours later, he had about $300,000 or $400,000 of his money. So it was, he was glad that he didn't mind, no money, no problems, but. That's Bobby's Room is what we're talking about in the Bellagio, and that's a very private room. You can play for as many high stakes as you want, and you're going to get some pros going in there against some guys that are businessmen and guys that are, you know, want to test themselves in those situations.
It's all relative. You know, people want to feel the burn of gambling and losing and winning. You know, if someone's worth $100 million and they lose $5,000, I mean, they just like
that's like most it's, of them it's like won't it's
care.
Like a parking meter for them. More
yeah,
or
I
less.
Mean, there is the guys like I've played with guys that are nearly billionaires that play super tight and hate losing, and that's the reason why they have $500-700 million.
I think that Bev is gonna shove it, and that's a good spot with Ace Jack. She has 50,000. The blinds are at 6-12 and about to go up to 10-20. And Patrick looks like is gonna call with ace three. Or did he call? It looks like he did not call. That's interesting. He did not call. I'm surprised that he didn't call with only three big blinds.
In the small blind.
So it's a small blind. Yeah, that was interesting.
It's like the same exact situation, basically, right? Except
for
we had one more player.
And Patrick's been.
She was in the high jet,
but it was. I'm kind of surprised knowing where he was. I mean, at this point, because of the blind structure, I mean, he's only a 13 big blind, so I guess.
Yeah.
The chips. It was kind of a situation with the chips and actually where his big blinds were, but. That was interesting. I would have thought he would have snapped it off, but I think, again, he knew her range.
Yeah, for sure.
And
yeah.
She's rewarded in some sense because she didn't have to go up in a situation where she get out flopped. And she holds up, and Vinny, who's had a lot of medium pairs since he sat down, he sits down, and he will raise. He'll go a little bit over two times the big blind with sevens. A lot of folds around him. And it comes back to Lynn, who's probably not going to make the call with 3-7. And she does not. And I think she told him 3-7. So that was interesting. Sometimes honesty is the right policy in that situation, because she's probably going, really, she must have had a really terrible hand not to call that very minimal raise, and she did. She didn't.
Yeah, Lynn's pretty awesome. I met her last night for the first time, and she's just, like, very
salt of the earth. I played against her a few times, and I hope that we didn't come off when we were talking earlier that we were being critical. We just didn't hear the situation that she was in. She obviously must have thought in that situation with the Queens that she was up against a set, because that's the only way you fold in that situation.
Yeah.
and she maybe, you know, I don't know if she knew William or not, but William had been pretty aggressive, but he'd been, you know, pretty, he hadn't been out of line too often, and she must have really felt in that situation that she mightn't have gotten unlucky, because it looked like she was setting up to make a move, and it didn't materialize, and she didn't call off the all-in raise, and I guess she wanted to stick around, and she's still here, so
yeah.
She knows maybe better than us right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I know.
And she is. I played against her a few times, and she's very nice, very, very good temperament at the table, and that's always something you like to see.
Yeah. And this whole experience has been so much fun for me. I just, like, didn't know what to expect at all.
So maybe we could get you back, or there's some, you know, if the situation, your schedule warrants, because I know that,
yeah.
I know it, when I talked to Sean and Matt Gianetti about this 2 years ago, and they were just, you know, look, obviously, like you, they play in a lot of big tournaments, they play all over the world, and they said, hey, for a charity poker tournament, this is pretty good, the
yeah.
competition's been pretty good, it's obviously for a very good cause, and everybody's having fun and playing it the right way. You're not seeing anybody slamming cards down when they lose.
Yeah,
or,
yeah, yeah.
That's what you want.
Yeah.
In this kind of a tournament, that's exactly what you want.
Yeah, and it's only a one-hour flight from Baltimore direct to Albany, so that's always
good. I used to cover Siena College, so I used to go down and cover Loyal, and spend a lot of time down there. Love the Italian restaurants in Baltimore for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm sure you've frequented those a few.
Yeah, I mean, I'm more of a steak and mashed potatoes.
Oh, Grimaldi's maybe,
yeah.
Or there. McCormick's, what do you call that? What's that? That's in the Inner Harbor. Can't think of that place. Something in McCormick's.
McCormick and Schmidt?
Yeah.
That
place is packed always.
Yeah, I've been there a few times. Mm-hmm. I actually went there for my prom, dinner senior year. I don't know why. But, yeah, I mean, Ruth Chris.
Mm-hmm.
They have them all over, but...
Did you get to go out last night after you? Now, what time did you guys get? You guys were playing last night. How did
yeah,
you get...
I got knocked out at like 10:30. I would have played cash until 5 or 6 in the morning, just
mm-hmm.
to like, I don't know. Just I was having fun last night, but
mm-hmm.
I knew that today was going to be a long day, and I had to get up early. So I was.
And you saved your voice for us, which is good. I saved my voice for me too. That was good. I broadcast the game last night, so it was. I wasn't feeling good. I actually slept in a little bit because I was worried about my voice. A little sore throat, and then I've made it through so far, so that's good. And we see Vinny once again has folded around to him, and ace 9, and looks like he's going to put in for a raise, and he does so. And Ron does not want to do much with 2-7.
Yeah. Oh, they're checking down.
And
T-shirt.
That was very nice, prudent check downs from both. And
yeah.
Vinny's like, yeah, I'm more than happy to check it down, because he has to think that ace 9 after no betting was going to be good, and he was right. And he increases his chip lead at this table, 333,000, as we're at 6 and 18 and about to go up to 10 and 20 here shortly.
31.
It looks like we're down, Greg, to about 3 or 4 tables. So we're down, probably, I would think, a little over 30 players left. So
yeah, I think they just said there was 33 left.
Mm-hmm. And we're down, actually down right now. Looks like we're down to 30 players. And we're going to take a short break at the end of this hand. And then we will be back for our fourth hour of coverage here from the All In for Wishes, the fourth annual, here in Albany, New York, at the Empire State Convention Center. Nice little facility for a charity poker event, and they've done a very good job. And Leahy's tables donating the featured table here for us. And that's Ted Leahy, Lucky Leahy's tables. Pretty nice little table with the odds and every obviously opportunity for people at home here to watch and see what's going on. That's always better for a poker broadcast than trying to speculate what they have.
Yeah, and this chip software is just amazing. Like
mm-hmm.
I did some of the one drop commentary this summer where they were
mm-hmm.
using the cards, or actually I'm not sure if they were until the final table, and I did commentary with like 20 something people left. I feel like they weren't using them yet, and they only
mm-hmm.
used them for final tables, which would make more sense. But to see it working so
it's,
well,
and
it's
it
so
is
cool.
working really
yeah.
well.
It's so much better than seeing. Although I do like the peel.
Yeah, the peel.
You know?
So
it's cool.
And you get the occasional grumpy player only wants to show one.
Yeah, I like to see him pop up though.
Mm-hmm.
It's just clean and it doesn't. It doesn't slow down. It speeds everything up.
I will.
Well, we live. We're gonna take it to the end of this particular hand. We get a new dealer here, and Tim, who some people may be watching this that have some local ties. He has been a dealer previously at Turning Stone, so a lot of the players that have local ties know who he is. He has a very good temperament, and he's the new dealer at this table.
We're all in for 2.5 bigs.
Mm-hmm. And obviously, that's a no-brainer decision at that point for him. And Stan, for those who are just joining us, that's Stan Merson. That's Greg Merson's father. And we are going to get a fold from seat number 8. Bev is going to fold, and he can't get a caller, which is not helping his cause. So yeah. Stan Merson is still at 4 big blinds and 64,000, and we are going to take a break, and we'll come back soon for another hour of coverage here from All In for Wishes.